Well, what I want to talk about is the San Juan Basin being a castaway, not a cast out. And those that remember the movie Castaway might have an appreciation for what I'm getting ready to talk about, because it's a terrific story about overcoming challenges, and that's how I'm looking at the San Juan Basin right now. But before we begin, one of the things that I'd like to do is just recognize that that the COVID-19 pandemic is upon us. There are a great number of impacts to our economy, obviously, and to people's lives. And so far, in the state of Colorado, there's been 1,373 people who have lost their lives. New Mexico, 440, and Texas, 1,983. And no matter what your position is on masks or no masks or whatever your political affiliation is, these are still lives that have been lost. And I think that it's important for us to take a moment and remember those lives that have been lost since we've been overcome by this pandemic. So thank you for that opportunity. Moving on then, just a little bit about myself. I'm a native of Farmington, a UNM grad. I was a senior staffer for the New Mexico State Senate from 96 to 2001. I was a city councilor and chair of the New Mexico Oil and Gas Association. I was a member of the Michelle Lujan Grisham Environment Department Transition Team, Methane Advisory Panel, and I am currently a convener of the New Mexico Energy Transition Committee, which is the committee that is seeking to transition from a coal-fired power plant here in the Four Corners to some sort of alternative energy that is based upon the Energy Transition Act that was passed by the legislature in 2019. I'm a former member of the Economic Development Commission and current member of the COVID Economic Recovery Council on behalf of the state of New Mexico. And also just recently been, I don't know, elected is the right word, but I am now the chairman of the Western States and Tribal Nations Natural Gas Initiative, which is a really exciting initiative that we'll talk about here in just a little bit. My job is that I'm the executive vice president of the Aztec Well family of companies. We're a drilling and well servicing contractor primarily based in the San Juan Basin, but we also have rigs in the Permian Basin. At one point, we were operating in the Hugoton, the Marcellus, in the Uinta, the San Juan, Permian, and we have definitely felt the impact of the collapse of nat gas prices back dating to 2008 when nat gas collapsed from 15 to 2. So as a drilling contractor, these are real impacts in my life. Looking at the industry outlook, this is the cast out part. Rigs are coming into town and being shut down. Unemployment is headed up, and the impact is scary. I think Dr. Fine covered that quite well. The prediction for rigs in the San Juan Basin right now, for the foreseeable future, are zero drilling rigs. The Permian capital spend is looking to drop from $29 billion to $12 billion. Permits are down. There will be an oil production decline, which Dr. Fine covered very well. The recurring revenue budget in the state of New Mexico is looking to be about, $2.2 billion below what was expected when the budget was passed. And as an industry, we are confronted with economic development professionals using the word diversification as a buzzword that identifies that really what they want to do is go away from oil and gas development because they see it as very volatile. And so there, it's critical for us as an industry and as a state to look at how we can promote responsible and safe and viable fossil fuel production. And that's some of what I'd like to talk about here today. And we also, as part of that, need to provide a safe haven for ESG investors looking for financial institutions that are trustworthy and defensible. That's a reality in the investment world today. And as an industry, we need to make sure that we are providing to what those demands are. And all of that is because the San Juan Basin and really the state of New Mexico and our oil and gas business is too important. It's too important for the state. It's too important for the United States. Just looking at New Mexico, there's 1,134 oil and gas businesses in the state directly employing over 26,000 people. There are 4,000 who have filed for unemployment in the past 3 months as a result of the pandemic and the collapse in commodity prices. There's expected to be another 1,500 to 2,500 jobs that could falter, with over $500 million in lost wages across the state, with an impact of a decline of $20 million in personal income tax collections. And these businesses, these 1,134 businesses plus the operating companies, have had a $6 billion taxable gross receipts impact into the state. So our industry is just simply too important. And the fact of the matter is that that is recognized by a great number of leaders, from the federal government down to the state to regulatory agencies. Our recovery actions have been focused on keeping the energy sector moving and producing to the extent possible by being considered essential employees according to the Department of Homeland Security, which was adopted by the state of New Mexico and tribal governments. There are effective COVID-safe practices that are in place to ensure that we can operate in a safe manner. There's been an extension of idle well time limits to prevent unnecessary production, and there's also been regulatory relief as requested by the New Mexico Oil and Gas Association and IPA&M. There's a push to secure federal money to plug orphan wells, to get rig companies like mine to go take care of a large number of wells that remain across the United States that need to be plugged. And the state continues with a safe opening based upon a favorable health data, with phase two expected in the near future. All of that is around a very clear understanding from the state of New Mexico's perspective that state-to-state competition for oil and gas capital spend is fierce. And that's not only for oil and gas, but for every industry doing business in the state of New Mexico, but with the impact that oil and gas has on our state budget and our employment numbers, there is dedication to ensuring that we can operate into the future. Which then brings me to work that I'm doing with the Western States and Tribal Nations Natural Gas Initiative. New Mexico just recently joined this coalition. As Jerry talked about earlier, back in the day, my father and Mr. Dugan and other leaders, Mr. Greer, came together to promote San Juan natural gas in a market where we were looking at 10 to 15 cents per unit And this this movement for the natural gas exports through advocacy by the Western States and Tribal Nations Organization, it is simply an extension of that, just understanding that we're in a new market and a new world. This organization is dedicated to promoting the consumption and the export of Rocky Mountain natural gas as promoting the right jobs and the right supply and right for the environment. Rocky Mountain natural gas has been ignored, and we are seeking to promote natural gas exports and accelerating fuel switching and decarbonization both locally and globally. We are also focused on building a comprehensive Rocky Mountain export infrastructure, looking where there are choke points in our pipeline infrastructure to prevent us from being able to export, and also looking at promoting LNG export facilities. And we are looking to partner with other organizations for a sustainable future, talking about that ESG investment piece. So very specifically, we're speaking from a New Mexico perspective, from a San Juan gas perspective, having active conversations with Costa Azul. Costa Azul is in phase one, where they'll be looking for half of a BCF per day. And at the end of the day, when we began conversations with Costa Azul, which is a Sempra facility, where they're going to be reversing from LNG import to LNG export, they really didn't even know that Rocky Mountain natural gas existed. That sounds funny to say, but they were very focused on the associated gas from the Permian and looking at how they could transport that gas to their facility. And now with the supply destruction that's coming out of the Permian based upon the low oil commodity price, they are looking for something more long-term and dependable. And I will say that Rockies gas has got their attention, which is an exciting development for us that's being promoted by the Western States and Tribal Nations. So just looking at the amount of gas that the Rocky Mountains have, we're looking at 565 TCF, and looking specifically at the San Juan Basin, the cumulative natural gas production in through late 2009 was totaled at 42.6 TCF. Most estimates are saying that there is at least double, if not triple, that available, that is primarily derived from four different formations, which is a sustainable and dependable source of fuel for LNG exports that are anticipated over the next 30 to 40 years. Of course, the Piance Uinta Basin also has substantial gas resources, as does the Greater Green River Basin. So going from a cast out to a cast away, like in the movie Cast Away begins with lots of doom, but then you've got Tom Hanks persevering, and then he goes through a process of awakening, and then finds a new day. And our new day is about a worldwide fuel switch. According to Shell, Asia will absorb more than 70% of the annual growth in LNG demand through 2040. And we know that renewable energy needs natural gas. 80% of the global energy demand by 2040 will be met by renewables, which will be 37% of it, and natural gas, which will be 43%. As I said, there's exciting developments with Costa Azul. Sempra has now announced a 20-year sales and purchase agreement for phase one, with a final investment decision that's going to be coming within the third quarter of 2020. So very, very quickly. Again, this is half a B of demand per day that they're looking to fulfill quickly. Jordan Cove, there is some movement on Jordan Cove while it is difficult, but the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission has decided to certify the construction of the LNG facility and the Pacific Connector Pipeline project. And Western States and Tribal Nations is actively involved in supporting the Jordan Cove project as well. And finally, we're having active conversations about synergies between natural gas, particularly pipeline infrastructure, and hydrogen for future opportunities looking at ESG investments in the industry. And our castaway is about, because tomorrow the sun will rise, and who knows what the tide could bring. And that's what Chuck Nolan said in Castaway. And because I had the fortunate opportunity to be home and watch that movie with my son here very, very recently, it moved me to, in thinking about the San Juan Basin, about we really don't know what the tide could bring, but I know that the Rocky Mountain producers of natural gas are strongly supportive of doing everything that we can to promote the export of nat gas, both dry gas to Mexico and for export to Asia, which we think that there's a strong market between now and 2040. So with that, Jerry, I appreciate the opportunity to talk, and certainly willing to answer any questions, and just really appreciate everybody's attendance today, and would really urge folks to get involved in the conversation about westward movement, infrastructure for nat gas, and the export of this resource, because there's a real opportunity. There's no question that there is a glut at this given moment based upon other export facilities and COVID. But I think that most experts will say that there is good hope for liquefied natural gas exports into Asia based upon fuel switch. And it's the right thing for the globe, with environmental fuel switch in mind. So just wanted to provide that perspective. Appreciate the opportunity to be on the panel with Dr. Fine. And Jerry, thank you very much for bringing everybody together.
My pleasure. That was an awesome presentation. I forgot to, the beginning of the conversation, forgot to put on my Aztec drilling hat, which in previous life,
I appreciated it, Jerry.
A lot of vertical wells for me. And we'll hope to have you drilling some horizontal wells here soon. But is there any comment that you have on the session coming up next, this Thursday, I guess, is the New Mexico Legislature special session? Any 1 minute overview?
You know, Jerry, I would just anticipate that legislators are going to get in and get out as quickly as possible. They're going to address budget issues, perhaps a couple of little fixes that need to be put into place as a result of COVID, maybe some racial justice issues that if they're able to get things taken care of pretty quickly. But my prediction would be 2.5, maybe 3 days max, in and out very, very quickly. And by all reports, that the legislature and the executive are very close as it relates to a budget deal. So looking to address the critical nature of where we're at and then move on.
Okay. um,